Well, hello, everybody. I'm so glad that you joined us, and we are coming live with Justin Warren. This is my nephew, and we are in his shop, his wife, Neri. This is where it all happens, you guys, and I can tell you that I remember when Justin was little, we never threw away blow dryers or radios. You never threw them away because Justin, he was an inventor when he was just a little boy. And he would find something to make out of him. Is that right, Justin?
Definitely. I was so excited. That was the only toys and objects that I could take apart and not get in trouble for. I'd always repurpose the gifts that we got on Christmas.
Yeah, so, you know, right now he has a prosperous business. You see the sign behind me? He makes these guys. He makes them. Right. Puts them all together. And, Justin, you've just got to have this need to create, right?
I have to. I feel like I have to move forward and learn. I love to learn. That's
yeah.
The secret. So,
but something happened to you recently, and well, I want to tell you first. The name of our devotion is called "Roll with the Punches." There used to be a song years ago. Her name was Tina Gadberry. She wrote it, and it said, "I'm like a rubber ball. If I fall, I'll bounce back up. Always up.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I'll face each trial and test and do my best because I'm."
Blessed.
I'm tough.
Yeah.
And I'm blessed.
I'm tough.
Yeah.
Through Christ, I'm tough. That's right.
That's right.
I was really little.
Yeah, that's right. But he says, I'll roll with the punches. You know, that was one of the lines in there that I've never forgotten. And so when I say roll with the punches, you adapt to hardships that come unexpectedly to you. And, you know, I was thinking, because the roll with the punches in boxing, right?
Yes. Yeah. Always got to roll and move and avoid the hits and get back up if you get down.
That's right. So, but something happened to you about 10 days ago.
That's right.
That sent you on a roll of your life. So I want Justin to go into this story, and he's with us today by the grace of God. And I want you to look behind us. That's a crotch rocket. I hesitate because I say it wrong every time. And you build them. You built
that one. That one was built. The one I was riding that day. Which we're going to talk about, I didn't build. I bought that one. It was a little too fast for me.
How fast do they go?
That one goes over 200.
Don't they make you nervous? I mean, when you're going down the road, just last week, it was like, zzz, I mean, just in and out of traffic. Do you do that?
Yes.
Oh, yes.
No one's looking.
Oh, my goodness. So, first I want to get into the word. Psalms 37 and 5 says, commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. So commit there means to roll upon. You know, when we turn everything over to the Lord, it's like we just hand it, we roll it over to him. And so we don't try to do it on our own, right? Because then we can find ourselves eating the dust or the asphalt. Mm-hmm. So Justin, take us into the story. It was a windy day, all right?
Yes, it was a wind advisory, actually. And I kind of ignored that. I really wanted to ride because it was warmer than usual. And so I chose to ride my bike over my vehicle that day, despite the wind, and I was having some fun on it. In fact, I was heading back from Sykeson to Cape to meet my wife. She actually invited me to this new tea restaurant at Cape.
Okay.
And so I wanted to go ride the bike there, and it was a really fast S1000 double R, if anyone knows what that is.
No.
BMW makes it. It's pretty quick. And it's easy to get up in the air. It has a lot of power. It runs to ride a wheelie.
So wait, you were riding a wheelie?
Well, I was getting there. So
how fast were you going when you were making this wheelie?
This wheelie, I was in the air. I went from 55 to 70 miles an hour pretty quickly. It was a pretty high wheelie. And I was, a wind gust actually hit me at 70.
Wow. And what happened? Wait, you were with your brother.
So he was riding behind me. He had a headset on so we could talk to each other through intercom. And he was probably a couple hundred feet behind me. And we were riding somewhere towards Cape. And anyway, up in the air it went. And balancing at that balance point in a wheelie, it'll take very much to push you one way or the other. And a strong wind, which they say the wind gusts were 50 miles an hour.
Wow.
That day.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Wow. That's too much wind to be riding a bike, right?
Yes.
Any type, really. So your bike flipped. You were on the highway, and there were cars coming. So tell us what happened.
Okay, so the wind blew me backwards, and I flew backwards, landed on my bottom for a second, and then doing 70 miles an hour, you don't just sit there. You flip and all this stuff. The bike tumbled and destroyed itself. I slid and flipped about 1,000 feet.
Wow.
I had gear on, guys, and it ate through the protective gloves I had on.
We'll show some pictures, see if we can give you an idea. So the bike was all in pieces.
So this was after the protective gear.
This went through your protective gear, right?
Yes, yes. And if you're sickly easily, I advise you don't look at it. They're kind of gross.
And he had long sleeves and a jacket, and it went through that.
Through the jacket, through...
Oh, no, your legs too.
Yeah.
Oh,
hurt.
My goodness. Wow. Now, Justin, when this happened, were you calling on the name of Jesus?
I was thinking about it. I was like, oh,
Lord.
You were
just thinking about it.
You know, that day, I felt something was off, and I kind of... You know, sometimes you get up and it's a rush and you just kind of like, you know, you need to spend time in prayer. That way you're sensitive to the Holy Spirit when he speaks to you. And that day with work and everything, I just wanted to just kind of break away at that moment from my busy morning. And I felt something was off.
Because Justin, he's a businessman, but yet, you know, he's got you keep the little boy alive in you. So the boy toys, he creates them, makes them. So you had that need for speed that day, and then you quickly began to roll, and you explained that a car was coming, and you raised your hand.
As I was sliding towards the end, when I finally got my bearings, I was sliding backwards. My feet were going that direction, and I was actually burning the tips of my fingers trying to stop myself from sliding. It's like being on a water slide, except it's sandpaper. It's eating you away. And I remember looking up, and there was a car with a white bumper coming at me. I was in a four lane, and I raised my hand getting ready to push off of the car because I saw the car coming at me, and it was close, really close. And I raised my hand, and the car was able to, they saw me, and they hit the brakes the last split second. It was neat, too. I noticed that when we got off and back in on the bike and looked at everything, my helmet didn't have a single scratch on it.
Wow.
No. Yeah.
I mean, it's the hand of God. So, Neri, tell us, you're expecting him to meet you at this restaurant.
I am. Well, he was supposed to meet me hours ago. And I was just like, just come now. He's like, well, I'm going to go home and I'm going to get the other bike. I was like, just come in the one that you are. So we kind of had a little argument about that. We did. So before everything happened. And so I get to the tea place. And I'm ordering my tea, and I'm telling the owner of the place, like, I can't wait for my husband to be here to try some of your tea because we've been into teas. And I just felt something off, too. I was like, I don't know where he's at. I was like, something is off. He's not here yet. Mm. It's taking too long. And then I get a phone call, and it's him. And I know him. I mean, we're so connected, not only as a married couple, but we're best friends. So we know how... We talk, we feel, we know that. And he gets on the phone and he's like, maybe you should go home. And I was like, go home? I was like, what do you mean? What are you talking about? Where are you?
Yeah.
He's like, I had an accident. It didn't take me 2 minutes. Now, I ran out of there because previous to this, he had just had another one, which was not his fault. In the summer, he had another accident. So all those emotions just came out again.
Yes.
And so I go over there. I don't even know how fast I was going, how I missed the lights, but I just got there. I didn't even have time to press on the brakes. I just put my car in park and it just made this loud sound because I saw him laying on the floor. I didn't know it didn't happen there. I didn't know it happened on the main street. So me getting there and seeing him on the floor, my heart just sank. And I didn't know what to do. And I was just shaking.
Yes.
To the point where when he got up, I was about to throw up because I just felt, you know, anxious because this is my partner.
Right,
and to
see
him hurt was hard.
But you guys, I'm sure that you thank God after the fact that he spared your life. And are you selling that crotch rocket?
Yeah.
He's got two beautiful children, little children. And it's...
It's for sale.
It's for sale.
I'm fixing it first. It's going to look really nice. It's a really nice bike.
But God spared you in that accident, and you rolled with those punches, but something happened in your life at 18. How old are you now? You're in your 30s,
right? I'm 31.
31. Okay, but you... There was a time when you felt you were kicked down, and you were, I mean, out for the count. This is when you were 18 years old. And so tell me about that and how that God rescued you and he came to you just in time.
Yeah, so I haven't really shared this story. A lot of people don't know about it. Some people don't really believe stuff like this could happen, but this is true and it happened to me. I find myself with so-called friends at a bar. It was actually a kind of a club-like place, and I was just so empty. I remember taking a lot of heavy drinks, and just because everyone else was doing it, and it's a cool thing to do, and you know, you feel accepted because they're doing it with you. And so the night was getting late, and the so-called friends, I don't know where they went. I realized I was being used as a ride and money. That's pretty much what I was there for, to get them there because they had too many DWIs and they couldn't drive anymore because they had an alcoholic problem. And so I would only drink there socially, but I found myself just asking this question. I was like, what am I doing here?
Yeah.
I don't belong here. I don't want to even be here. And I'm sitting at this bar stool. The bar is behind me. I'm looking at the crowd. There's a dance. There are music's lights. It's just going, you know, blaring. And I see people doing what they do at a bar. You know, they're all drunk and they're all dancing and carrying on. And I look at them and I just like, I don't belong. This is not me.
Yeah.
No one belongs there. But I found myself asking myself that on the inside. I'm like, I don't belong here. And I just felt like I really, really, really wanted to leave.
And so were you at the bottom as far as in your life, like, were you depressed or just, why were you headed there? Just, do you feel like you were just at the lowest time in your life?
Yeah. So I was having a hard time finding someone to, you know, to be with. I had a girlfriend that just kind of put me through a lot and we had broken up and just a lot of emotions, a lot of emptiness and wondering. Yeah. You know, about my future. So that can make you depressed if you don't know about the Word of God. And I knew the Word of God, but I, you know, how it applied to me directly, that was something that I had to experience and learn and just ask God for revelation. And so...
But you had an encounter, Justin.
This is, in that moment, I'm sitting in that stool looking at the club. I was, let me recall how this was exactly. He was on my left side. So I felt Jesus actually visited me there. He put his arm around me. He's on my left side, his arm around me, and He put his head next to mine like this, and he was looking at what I was looking at. He didn't mention to me what I was doing there. He didn't even mention the fact that I was there, and he wasn't mad at me, and I was amazed by that. I felt that, and I'm just kind of like freaking. This is happening. Yeah. This is real, and he said, you see all those people over there? And I said, yeah. And I'm just like, Jesus is here. He's talking to me. Just crazy. I said, yeah, Lord, I see them. He says, I called you to love all those, to minister to those people, you know, to win those people to me. I called you to do that. And he said, I'm like, yeah, I want to do that. I want to do that. And I'm thinking, I can't do that in this position I'm in. I'm doing what they're doing. But he said, look at everything in their lives to this point that brought them to where they are right now. And I saw a video appear above all their heads, a little screen.
Wow.
Above all their heads. And I would look at, focus on one, I was there. And I saw parents. I saw dads yelling at their daughters, saying, you're worthless, you're trash. I saw abuse. I saw so many parents and friends cutting each other down and cursing each other. I saw stuff that actually started from their childhood. And so they were all empty. They're all there trying to feel something. And actually, I was not just seeing it. I was experiencing it. I was feeling these emotions of brokenness of all these people.
Yes.
And I was feeling it all at once. And it was tearing me up. I was bawling my eyes out. And I said, make it stop. And he did, because it was too much. And just think about that. He feels that across the whole entire universe all at once. He feels your heart. He knows what you're going through.
That's
right. The pain. He feels it. And he let me experience that little bitty room right there for about, I don't know how long, about 5 minutes. And I couldn't handle it. And wow. But what I saw was I had love for them.
Yes.
And that's how he sees us. He sees the hurting people are hurting people. They desire to be fed. And we are always out there. Sometimes we're lost. We're trying to find our own way. We try to feel our own selves. It ain't possible to feel yourself. You're not your own creator.
That's right.
You aren't meant to do that. That's his job. And he made a way. And I told God, I said, make me sober now. I want to leave. And he did. And I walked out and I heard the Lord say, your keys. Oh, I forgot about that. Turned around and the bartender, I said, hey, bartender, my keys now. He goes, no, I know what you had to drink. I don't think so. I said, keys now. He grabbed the keys. He said, your funeral, and threw them at me. It was dark in there and I caught it. Didn't miss it. And I left, turned on some worship music, headed home, started praying, asked God forgiveness, and just kind of evaluating what just happened. And it started hitting me like, oh my gosh, such love.
How he rescued you.
Yeah.
You know, Psalms 37, 23 through 24 says, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delights in his way. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholds him with his hand. And that's what you felt. You felt the Lord's hand lift you out of that place, that dark place, the place of confusion. And I mean, it was really utter chaos to you. It was like, this is not even where I belong. And so I want to say that, you know, you may have fallen. You know, you roll with the punches. You get back up. You get back up. And you may feel like, well, I've gone way too far for God to love me. But, you know, he showed you in that moment how much he loved you, even when you were, I mean, you were drunk. You were, I mean, you had just, you know, had just cashed it in at that moment. Like, yeah. I'm just, you know, letting my hair down, whatever. And just, you know, not even realizing, you know, what was taking place. But he rescued you in that moment.
He showed me love too. He didn't judge me. He wasn't mad at me. He didn't convict me. He said, I came to save the world, you know, not to condemn the world, because their hearts condemn them already.
Right.
We know what's right and what's wrong.
That's right.
Whether you know God or not, you know what's right and what's wrong.
Well, the Bible says that even the Ten Commandments are written in the tablets of our heart. And so we do. We do know right from wrong. And when we're sensitive to that, he'll show us the way. He said, your steps are ordered by the Lord. And there's times when things hit you, you roll with those punches, you get right back up. So Justin, I'm going to ask if you would to lead us in prayer. Because some of you may have fallen. You may be in that place that he's talking about. And you may be rolling, you know, on the asphalt, or, you know, and God's, you know, God's getting ready to spare your life. I mean, it could be a devastation.
Yes.
But he loves you and he's reaching for you.
He does. Let's pray. Lord, Father, we just come before you right now.
Thank you, Jesus.
Well, we know there's those listening right now, God, that are hearing your voice, God. Their hearts are being touched right now, Lord, by this testament, God, you've given us. And Lord, I ask right now that you deal with this situation, God, in their life right now, and show them, God, that you're not the God that loves, God, with limits, but you love unconditionally, and you don't judge, but you renew, you restore. God, your love is everything we need, that we lack in our lives. And through your love and the joy that you've given us, that gives us strength, Lord. And I just, right now, I declare strength and joy over those who are listening and those, even in the future, to hear this video, God. I just pray that you touch their hearts right now and touch them right where they're at, and ask you, Lord God, to open their eyes, oh God, right now, and touch them and restore them. In the name of Jesus, we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Justin, for sharing today. Listen, God loves you today. We love you. And have a great rest of your day. All right? Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.